Welcome to City Talk. I'm Joe Smith. I'm glad you're here. Who says you can never go home again? After 5 years in downtown Hillsboro, the Washington County Museum is back where it started, Portland Community College Rock Creek. Here to talk about the move and the new direction for the museum, Executive Director Pam Voracek. I got it. All right. Welcome. It's good to have you with us. You were the new executive director. It was in Hillsboro for a time, but then decided to move back home. How come?
For a number of reasons. We didn't see the audience that they anticipated when they first moved to Hillsboro. Our attendance numbers were smaller than anticipated, so that's one reason. Another reason is we're creating a new direction for the museum. We're going to be stepping outside the museum more, still have a museum, but doing programming and exhibits outside the museum. All of our staff now is concentrated or works in one location, which is super cool for collaboration. And economically, it makes sense to run one facility instead of two. Mm-hmm.
How did the museum come to be? When did it start?
So over 50 years ago, the museum started as Washington County Historical Society. Grew to Washington County Museum. It's had several homes over time, and we're just continually reinventing ourselves as we grow and linger on.
As most do. I mean, most people are kind of rethinking those old established ideas that we have of what a museum is. How are you trying to change that perception? Because I think sometimes when you say the word museum, you know, we think of, you know, someplace really dark and, you know, kind of stodgy, but not so with this museum.
As we go forward, you'll definitely be seeing the stories. We want to tell you stories about what's happening. We want to challenge some of your perceptions. One of the things that we anticipate that we'll be doing, we're working on a strategic plan, staff retreat, et cetera, is an exhibit about growth. And growth is a buzzword in this area. And so what did Washington County look like back then? And what does it look like now? And what could the future be? We also incorporate the arts and sciences into this museum, and we'll be doing more of that as well. So arts, sciences, humanities, besides just old stuff.
Old stuff. But the old stuff really defines, you know, where we were and where and how far we've come, though. So important to highlight those as well.
Oh, so very important. But let's tell the stories behind that as opposed to just an object. How is that object used? Who used it? Was it someone local? Where did it come from? Let's engage the community and talk about really important, relevant things.
Yeah. And one of the things I know is the timber industry, because it's just so indigenous to Oregon. So you have timber in the Tualatin Valley. What are some of the things that people will see when they go to the museum and they see that particular exhibit?
Oh, there are so many artifacts. There's probably 80 artifacts at least. And one of my favorites is this bellows. And the bellows is really hefty. It takes a couple of people to use it, to carry it. Probably stands from the ground up to about here. It's about this wide. And it was used in the blacksmithing industry, part of also the forestry industry. Mm-hmm. We have a bunkhouse with a still in there, and the kids
still interesting.
And the kids really like seeing the bed and the water containers, and of course, you know, saws and wedges and such as that. And one of my favorite things is it's a sign, but it's about women in logging. And so you actually have pictures of women in dresses that are sawing logs or working in the logging industry. Did you know that women worked in the logging industry?
Well, I didn't. I know it now because you just told me, but then they were also wearing dresses as they were sawing?
Yes.
That's amazing.
We have photos of that.
You do.
Yep.
So there's the proof. Some of the other things that you're also trying to do, I know you've got After Dark, if These Walls Could Talk. Tell me about that. I think that's kind of fascinating.
Oh, that was a fun event in October. So we had essentially a modern day ghost hunter, but he uses sciences behind his. So we have an old log jail that was built in 1853. It's right outside our main doors. And he and his, it's a family of ghost hunters. They spent some time in that jail recording sounds and seeing what else they could find. And then they gave a presentation, and we had over 30 people who were enraptured with what he was saying. No one pulled out their cell phone. I mean, he had everyone by, and they did find a corpse.
What? Wait a minute.
It was a...
A for real? Not yeah, a for real corpse.
It was, oh yes, it was a corpse of a mouse.
Oh, okay. Well, that could be. Well, it's if you like mice, then that's fine too. But so I mean, so you're trying to rethink the museum and really trying to add some, I guess some new life behind the exhibits and also behind what a museum is.
Yes.
Yeah. So talk to me about funding, because I think that funding is so important in keeping something like this going. I mean, we don't appreciate things so much until we lose them. And how is the museum funded?
So we are a private nonprofit, so a 501c3 organization. We get a little money from the county to, because it's actually the collection, the archives, belongs to the county legally. And so they give us some money to sustain and take care of their collection. We rely on donations. We apply for grants. We just found out about some grants coming from Reuser Foundation and a couple of other places coming up. So that's important. And we have to find a sustainable business model. And one of the things I think we're going to be doing going forward is we're going to offer the opportunity for businesses or nonprofits to ask us to pay us to research their business. So if you have a historic home or the history of a large company over time, we have the resources for that. We have great researchers, and we would provide you with some kind of document or presentation or something at the end of it. So that's one of the things. We have to find new
ways
of keeping going.
Yeah, because I think a lot of businesses, you know, probably the people who are there now don't know how it all started. And to that end, are you constantly looking for material that you can put into the museum? And if so, how do you scout that out and go after that stuff?
So right at this time, people come to us. We're not selectively going after others or other stuff. We have a limited space at this point, and we do accept donations. You know, I'm new. We have to establish some policies about where we're going after. But can we go back to the funding?
Sure.
For a second?
Okay, sure.
So a couple of other things that we do is our mobile museum program and field trip program. So the grants we're getting help offset some of those programs so that schools can benefit from our programs. We served over 237 mobile museum presentations at schools last year, and we're certainly on target or above that. And so we go out into the schools and give classroom presentations, hands-on activities, presentations, storytelling. We take artifacts with us as well. So that's another source of our funding.
A little show and tell. So tell us the hours, because the hours are not Monday through Friday. I mean, it's a little sporadic.
So we're open Wednesdays and Thursdays from 10 till 4. And then the second Saturday of the month, which incorporates our free family mornings, hands-on activities once again. So Monday and Thursdays from 10 to 4, and the second Saturday of the month from 10 to 4. However, if you need to come in on a different day, because your days off are different, give us a call. We'll try to accommodate you.
And it's a good opportunity for those who maybe don't know what a rotary phone is or a real typewriter is. they can bring the kids and show those off to them as well.
Right, that's in our Ladies of the Valley exhibit that showcases furniture and artifacts and dresses from 1910 to 1950.
How did they get all of these materials and preserve them? I mean, there's an art to that as well, isn't there?
So we have over 54,000 artifacts in our archives. Some of those are digital images and some are things the museum built onto the museum back in the 80s to start housing more and more. And then one of the other things we'll be doing coming next year is we'll be giving behind the scenes tours of some of our artifacts so you can actually go into the storage area.
Fascinating. All right, Pam, thank you so much for being here and good luck in new position and good luck with the museum.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.